Let's see the hands of the spokespeople for your groups. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What I'll do, 6. Let's see the other hands. There's got to be more than that. All right, I'm going to start this way and work that way. So you want to switch chairs because you wanted to go first, didn't you? All right, so here we go again. We've now got power. Hopefully it won't shut off this time. So what is fairness? Yeah, what is fairness? Equal? All right. What is equality? The same. Okay. I'll treat you all exactly the same. I'll give everybody in the class Fs. That's the same. I'm treating you equally.
Giving everyone the same chance.
All right. What did you say was your answer for what is justice?
I said, or my group said, being fair by the individual.
So we have another fairness. All right.
But it's by the individual and or groups decided upon reward or consequence for any particular situation.
Okay, so you have this idea of it being within the context. So you said fair. So we've got another one for fair. What else did you say? Group?
Well, being fair by individual groups and their cumulative decided consequences or reward.
Reward, okay. Rewards. That might be called the desserts theory of justice. Giving everybody what they deserve, the reward. So rather than giving everybody an F in the class, I give you your reward based on what?
Performance.
Okay. All right. Your examples?
For minors.
For
minors.
Let's go with yours. What were your examples?
For fairness, we broke down by the trial by jury for Brown versus Board of Education.
Okay.
Like that ended up being fair. It was decided upon a group and everybody decided this is a fair outcome for the situation.
Okay.
The other one was UCO's diversity. Like if we're talking where you throw equality into fairness, it's UCO has decided to make it as neutral and as friendly to all cultures and diversities as possible.
Okay. So we have this product or service that we're selling here at UCO, and we don't say we're only selling it to certain groups.
Yes.
Now, one time we did. Before Brown versus the Board of Education, UCO was a white-only college. What was the African-American college in Oklahoma?
Langston
University. So the way the NAACP, in the last, when we talked about environmental scanning, the way they went about attacking that distribution of benefits, which is a service, the service of providing knowledge, was actually started by filing suits against Oklahoma. And they said, you don't have separate but equal in Oklahoma. And they said, you don't have a law school, because Langston didn't have a law school. We have a regents policy that says you can't duplicate programs at institutions. So who had the only law school in the state? Well, it's OU. And so they started by saying, well, that's not even separate but equal. So that was one of the first cases. Okay, so that's a distributive justice. What was your examples? What were your examples? Sorry, good English.
My examples.
For justice and marketing. Mm-hmm.
The customer ate one. And then we had, you want to be fair as in, you want to be kind to your customers because if you're not, then you lose them. Be kind, don't discriminate, be friendly, and welcoming.
Okay, so you also had some idea of kindness in your definition. Okay. All right, so in the first three rows, the next one's over. All right. So what did you all say for your answer? What is justice and what does it have to do with marketing?
We said that justice is conforming to the quality of being just, impartial, or fair.
Okay, impartial. So we have another one for fairness. So we have one for impartial, okay?
And then justice creates social and legal opportunities to reach consumers. So
okay.
Justice really is a big social game more than it is legal, I think, because the legal parts of justice come from mass social beliefs.
Okay.
Our three examples were the women's suffrage movement, for one, because it increased the number of consumers, and it also increased the amount of income coming home to families, which allows for a bigger market to reach. And then our next example was...
Okay, so I want to stop with your first example. There is a historian, an African-American female historian named Elizabeth Cohen, and she argues this, that what you just argued. She says that in a book called Consumer Republic, she says that basically equality and civil rights track with marketing rights. As consumers, as African Americans achieved middle class status and they became a consumer republic, and women, by the way, she says really women, a lot of the power that women achieved through our struggle for, so there's been three sort of epics in civil rights. The first was for African Americans, the second was for women, and the third, I think, was for gays and lesbians. And she says that women really achieved a lot of power because they controlled the family budget and decided how purchases were going to be made. And that was an example of how you got justice in a society as businesses recognized the preeminence of these individuals and their purchasing power. So that's an interesting point. Okay, what else?
Cigarettes not being allowed to advertise in America. It's not seen as fair, per se, to the cigarette companies because they don't get to reach people like they would like to. But going back to how justice is a social thing, like, it's more seen on Americans to not be able to smoke. Like, most Americans don't want you to smoke around them. You're not allowed to smoke in most public places. And then also, it's a regulatory force because the FDA has said that, so that impacts the...
Okay, so you've got some idea of regulation. We have this concept in this country that we are a free market economy. There's no such thing as a totally free market economy. If you had a completely free market economy, what could you have in that economy?
Drugs and guns.
Huh?
Drugs and guns.
You could have drugs and guns, yeah. You could sell. That's an interesting point because what is property? Okay, do you own your drugs?
Yes. I buy my prescriptions every month.
Okay, that's legal. But technically, drugs are not property. I mean, legal drugs are sort of property, I guess. But property has three characteristics. So is your cocaine property?
They sure charged me for it. I mean, they catch you in my car and turn it
forward. Property has three characteristics. It's alienable, divisible, and descendable. What it means by alienable is during my lifetime, I can give it away legally, I can sell it legally, or I can abandon it. Those are the three things I can do during my lifetime with my property. So if I own this marker, I can give it away, I can give it to you, you can take it. I can abandon it. I can throw it on the floor and it becomes abandoned property, discard it. Or I can leave it to somebody or it will pass through the intestacy statute. Does your cocaine have that quality?
No.
Yeah, if you give it away or sell it during your lifetime, what's going to happen? You're going to go to jail. That's not legal, right? If you try and leave it to your heirs or your assigns in your will, the court is going to say, no, 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 that's not, no, can't do that. And you can't, it won't pass through the intestate statute. So there's this, so we don't have a totally free economy because we regulate some things. You know, you can, things that you may think of as being property, you can touch the cocaine. You can see it, but it's not property. Some of the things that you may think of as being property are actually not property. What about your body? Is your body your property?
Not according to Donald Trump.
Not according to Donald Trump. Your body's not your property. You can't stuff yourself and leave yourself to your kids. And you have to be disposed of in a certain way. You can't sell things. It's creepy. We don't let you do that. So some of the things that you might not think of as being property, things that are ideas that are out there, are actually really, really valuable property. Patents. Patent protects this idea. That's useful, a useful thing. Copyright protects non-useful things, like the book. You can't just give the book away. It's got a copyright, right? And then trademark. So property, so we don't have a completely free economy. Also, if you had a completely free economy, this idea of regulations is important. And going back to that environmental scan is an important thing to note, because if we had a totally free economy, not only could you sell whatever it is you wanted to sell, but a completely open-based market economy, you could also have monopolies, couldn't you? If you had a completely free economy, you could have a monopoly. If you had total, unfettered capitalism, if I can buy all this stuff and get it together, you're interfering with my capitalistic rights by saying I can't do that. We don't allow it. So regulation is important. And we'll talk about whether or not it's the ultimate importance. Okay, what else did you say?
Men being used as makeup models now.
What's that?
Men are being used as makeup models now. Like CoverGirl just made their next CoverGirl man.
Okay, and how is that just? Or
it allows men that use makeup to, it reaches a whole new consumer area. Like,
okay.
It opens up a door for more consumers, and it's also seen as like justice for people that are fighting for equality rights in them.
Okay. Makeup companies, by the way, are coming up with men's makeup lines now. So recognizing that more and more men are actually wearing makeup. Historically, who wore makeup?
Men.
In ancient Egypt, who wore makeup?
Men.
The pharaoh. Okay, all right. So anybody from here over? Got to go back. All right, so what did you say justice was, and what does it have to do with marketing?
Okay, we wrote that justice is a degree of fairness, and it's important to consider in marketing strategies. Giving false information, an example of how markets can be unjust. While marketing, we need to be upfront and honest about our products. If you have a product that is small enough for a child to swallow and choke, one, you need to label it as that. Another way of being unjust is when something is advertised as free, but still requires a credit card info, so at the end of your free month, if you don't unsubscribe in time, you will be charged that amount of money. But the disclosure is in fine print, and if the consumer doesn't read it, they will feel misled and lied to. And if your product does not function properly and has to be recalled, it is important that the consumer is compensated. No one wants to be caught in the same position as Samsung, where they cannot refund the money of all their recalled phones, and where the CEO is now facing corruption charges. And it's important to prevent things like false charges, misleading advertisements, and inability to refund consumers when necessary. Therefore, we need laws to abide by while marketing your product to protect the consumer and the businesses, and to be fair on both sides.
Got another regulation. We got a whole lot of fairness. Okay, what do you think is fair? I mean, this is one of the things. What Donald Trump said in the primaries, for those of you who paid attention, he said, I will support the Republican nominee if I think the process that elects the Republican nominee, he wasn't quite this eloquent about it, is fair. And somebody said, well, what's fair? And he said, you know what fairness is. We know what fairness is. Do we? Is it a gut check? is it, you know?
I think it means different things to different people.
Ah, so there's
some
subjectivity. All right.
I think it has a lot to do with ethics as well.
Okay, so justice equals ethics, maybe?
I think it's kind of been defined by like the mass majority of society.
Majority? Okay, we got that. All right, so what else did you, you said something about honesty in the disclosure. So are they being honest when they say, so for example, you have all of these ads that you hear, Credit Karma. And they tell you that they don't require a credit card. And they don't. So how's Credit Karma, I mean, are they philanthropists? How's Credit Karma making money?
Sponsoring money because the credit card revenue is when you apply for them to your credit score.
Okay. They're also probably aggregating data on you. It's probably data aggregate, and they're selling that information. Should they have to tell everybody that, or should we just know that?
Buyer beware.
What's that?
Buyer beware.
That's a doctrine, a legal doctrine called caveat emptor. Yeah, and we went from let the buyer beware as a society, as a rule in law, to something called strict products liability. So you were talking about disclosure. You said something about if a toy is manufactured in such a way that there's a part that a child can swallow, that they have to have that. So we have all of these, you bought, how many of you bought toys and you saw all of the warning labels? And how many of you bought a hairdryer recently? There's a big honking warning label on the hairdryer, isn't there? It's got this picture, in case you can't read the warning label, it's got this picture of a bathtub with water in it and the hairdryer over the bathtub. And a big circle with a slash through it, red slash through it, which means what? Yeah, I'm kind of thinking that at this point, if you don't know that electricity and water don't mix, maybe you're a candidate for natural deselection. Really? We need a warning? Ooh, danger, Will Robinson. I don't know. Shouldn't you know when you buy the toy? You know, I get it that maybe they should disclose that there's lead in the toy, you know, so the kid doesn't lick the toy. But can't you sort of see, like, don't, I mean, shouldn't there be some level of, well, there's no such thing as common sense. There's rational, comprehensive thought and not. There's no such thing. I mean, people talk about common sense. It's like, it doesn't exist. It's like the mythical unicorn. You're either a rational, comprehensive person, or you're not. But as a rational, comprehensive person, shouldn't you just look at that and say, wow, that toy's got little parts. I shouldn't give it to my 3-year-old. Yes?
Well, I feel the same way. I feel like someone should be like, yeah, I know I can't give that to my child. But the thing that happens is that aren't rational people, and they give it to the child chokes, and something happens, or, you know, they drop the hair dryer in the tub, and someone gets hurt, and then they use the legal system to sue the company, so the companies put those warning systems on there to protect themselves from the consumers.
Okay. That's part of our law now. So maybe custom has something to do with that. All right. So anybody else from this point over? Let's see. Yes, what did you say? Okay, so you said fairness, and you also said equitable, which is equality. So we've got now 1, 2, 3, 4, 2 for equality. What else did you say?
We talked about how it has to do with human relations.
Human relations?
Yeah, okay. And how marketing is human relations, how we market products and people through things like ethics and integrity and honesty and quality.
Okay, ethics, integrity. What is integrity?
I think it relates more to honesty more than anything.
Okay, so you've got honesty as well. So we've got two. For, so you think integrity is a synonym for honest? Yes, ma'am?
I would say integrity basically means standing behind your product.
Okay, so you may not necessarily be honest, but you stand behind your product?
Well, it's a broad, it's inclusive of honesty.
Oh, so integrity assumes honesty, but honesty is not necessarily the end-all and be-all of integrity.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
And for examples of using ethics as justice is when a salesman is marketing a car at a higher interest rate than when customers don't know those interest rates, he marketed the interest rates higher than they actually should be, whereas it's not technically illegal that you're signing a contract, but it would be unethical.
Okay. So what constitutes higher than ethical interest rates?
I mean, this is an example of somebody told us in a different class. He would market those interest rates higher to the people that didn't know about it rather than the people that didn't know about it.
They do that all the time, though, don't they?
Yeah.
I mean, one of the things that happens, it's amazing, and you can do this with your credit card companies. Call them and tell them that you want to cancel their credit card. Yeah. Tell them you're going to pay it off and cancel it because their interest rate is too high. If you've got a good credit score, they'll lower the interest rate for you.
Right.
They'll do all kinds of things for you. Car dealers do this all the time, too, don't they?
Yeah.
They'll say, I'm burning coupons to get you this.
Yeah.
And what does that mean? So the car buying process is really, it's really interesting because there's sort of a bifurcated process there. You deal with the salesman, and then they're going to send you to the what? The F&I office, the finance and insurance office. And you can't negotiate the deal in one seamless transaction. You have to go to the F&I office. And that's just, it's like the black hole of ethics when you go to the F&I office. It is. It's amazing the markup on those products. So, how many of you have had Dr. Ice for finance in here? Anybody had Dr. Ice for finance? You had Dr. Ice for finance? About 7 years ago, Dr. Ice came to lunch and he was very upset because somebody had hit his wife's perfectly good 13-year-old Honda Civic with 225,000 miles on it. And he was going to have to go buy her a new car. And he said, what do you want? She said, the only thing I want is I want the extended warranty on this new car. And he said, okay, but when we get into the F&I office, don't say anything. Dr. Rice's wife's name is Kim. And so it started out with, I want the extended warranty. That'll be $2,000. Not going to take it. It was dropped down to $1,800. Not going to take it. $1,500. At this point, his wife starts panicking. He said she started digging her fingernails into my thigh. He got him down to $300. That's the markup on that product. Now, what is going to happen to the next person who goes in who's not as tough a negotiator?
He's
going to pay. Is that fair? Well, they can sell you. I don't know. Shouldn't, you know, again, let the buyer beware. Shouldn't you know about these things before you go do this? Shouldn't you do your research? I mean, this is not difficult to do in this day and age. You have this device that you can Google it. Can't you? Shouldn't you Google it at this point? I have a friend, he's older. He thinks Google is a person. He wants me to ask Google these questions. You know, it's like the Oracle of Delphi or something. So, okay, all right. Who else? You didn't sit in the third row, so you are going to have to really, really, really project.
All right,
hold on 1 second. I gotta try and get the camera adjusted.
Okay.
There we go. Got it.
So our group said that...
Louder.
Our group said that all justice is rules or laws to help prevent a wrong or to fix a wrong.
Rules, okay. Laws to prevent wrong.
But the way you judge wrong is based on your morals. Because we all have different morals, it can be different things.
Okay, so you've got some element of subjectivity. So
we
prevent
said
a wrong.
To have good morals, we have stuff like fairness, trust, transparency, righteousness, and equality. But other people may not have those views.
Okay, so we had fairness, trust, what else?
Transparency.
Transparency, okay, so is that disclosure, I guess? We have another one for disclosure. It's also sort of honesty, isn't it? Transparency.
Yeah.
Okay, so we got another one for honesty. So justice is a law to prevent a wrong. Everything I can do to you, have a legal remedy?
Not by like the written law, but there's other laws, all like laws of life and stuff. Like there's just some things you don't do to people.
Where the hell am I supposed to find that?
It's not really written, it's like, it's morals again. So it's not like it's written, I'm not just gonna go and hurt someone because it's, in our society you just don't do it, it's a law. I mean, we do it, but there's certain things that we just know not to do.
Okay.
There's a consequence.
Is there? Is there a consequence?
Not always.
What's your name?
Devin.
Last name?
Provines.
What?
Provines.
Provines. What's your Provines? Suppose I see you at your place of employment and I walk in to your employer and I say, I'm a professor of marketing at the University of Central Oklahoma. I had Mr. Provines in my class and I can't believe that you hired him. Why? He was an utter disaster. Every single time he opened his mouth, he subtracted from the sum total of human knowledge. His feet stink, and he doesn't love Jesus. Can you sue me for that? That's mean, isn't it? That's really, now let's suppose your employer fires you. Can you sue me for that?
Yes.
Defamation of
character. Is it defamation?
I mean, you can say history.
Is any of that subject to validation? Every time you open your mouth, you subtract from the sum total. What does that mean? Have I given anything more than my opinion there?
No, but...
I mean, compared to my dog... Right? I have these cute little dogs, and they're dumb. I love them. They're really, really dumb. You know, compared to my dogs, I'm Einstein, aren't I? I mean, I can do all kinds of things that my dogs can't do. I am a genius. Compared to Einstein, not so much. So isn't that a matter of opinion? Feet stink, isn't that a matter of opinion?
No.
No? I think it's a matter of opinion. I mean, how many of you have smelled a cologne that you thought was just god-awful? Somebody's marketing it, that's a matter of opinion. Yes, you were going to say in the back row?
Oh, but your opinion mattered so much that you got hired.
So?
But your opinion shouldn't matter.
Well, I didn't actually fire him. His boss fired him.
But the whole point is your opinion shouldn't matter that much.
But his boss apparently thought it did. I have lots of initials after my name. Gregory, B.A., M.A., J.D., Ph.D., right?
Yeah.
Doesn't that mean something? We think it means something. That.
It needs to be fast. I mean, you can smell his feet. That's the only thing you can do. His feet probably don't smell. So you can actually smell
smells, what makes your feet, I mean, you know, I don't know.
But you said his feet smell, so then...
So you think that's an objective fact?
Yeah, I mean, if they actually smell, you should smell them, right?
That's an objective fact. How many of you have smelled Elizabeth Taylor's White Diamonds perfume? Did you like it?
Yeah.
What are you, 100? I think it smells god awful. Yeah, I mean, it's horrid. All right, so if you did, come up and give me a list of your groups. I'm out of time, so we'll pick up with this. I want to make sure I get the rest of the group. So if your group went today and you discussed some, let me know.